Welcome to the Successful Real Estate Broker Podcast, where we learn about some success stories and some not so successful stories. But either way, we learn. Each episode, we talk with successful real estate agents and vendors about things they have done to make them successful and some things they did that you might want to avoid. Join us for each episode of the Successful Real Estate Broker Podcast with your host, Preston Sandlin.
Book. I'm going to go back. All right, listeners. Well, I have a treat for you here on the Successful Real Estate Brokers Podcast. I have Mr. Neal Pender. How are you doing this afternoon?
Great. How are you, sir?
Good, good. Well, Neal, I've known you a long time. I used to do inspections for you way back when we were probably first both getting started. And, you know, that was I think we must be about the same age. Both our pictures, baby pictures in black and white. So
you're holding your own a little better than I am.
Oh, please, please, please. You're doing all right, brother. But you know, some of the listeners and viewers out there, most people know who Neal is, but a lot of people don't. So tell us a little bit about you. And, you know, we're going to get into a whole bunch of stuff and have some fun, but Give us a little background. Who's Neal Pender?
So, you know, I born in Virginia, moved here in 1980, here being Concord, North Carolina. Went to college because at the time I was blessed to have had the opportunity to, but I had no real direction. So I graduated from Chapel Hill in 95, and all the places I interviewed with wanted me to have had either more school or more work experience. And so I think my mom gave me the idea to look into real estate. And so I talked to two family friends who had established agents, and they both said, don't do it. So what happens when you tell a 24-year-old not to do it?
They do it.
They do it. Here we are. So did that for a long time, and it's been 23 years. That was 1996. And then now, of course, still doing brokerage. I went out on my own. I've been with five or six different firms over the years. Went on my own back in 2 years ago. And then also around that same time, you have to take what's called a broker in charge course to learn how to be a broker in charge. And during that actual course, I was watching the instructor and I just randomly thought, I kind of was interested in teaching once upon a time. I think I could do that. And then the whole rest of the day, I thought about how it would be to teach a room full of people like me and those folks I was with. So I looked into it and it just dominoes clicked. And over the next 2 or 3 weeks, I did the training, got the certification, got connected with a local school who, and we'll talk about them later, just super supportive. It's Agents Choice School of Real Estate. Margie Bell and John Sylvia have been wonderful, super supportive. And so that's something I do on the side. The brokerage still comes first, but the teaching is a significant side thing that I'm doing as well.
Awesome. Well, I'm certainly going to get into that a little bit. I know a couple of things that I know about you. I know you know about hard work because I think we had a discussion one time about your dad changing those big truck tires and stuff like that and pulling tobacco and stuff like that. So we have that in common. Now, didn't you go to Carolina? Are you a Carolina fan?
That's right. That's right. I went to Carolina and graduated in 95.
Awesome. Awesome. I am a Carolina fan. I went to UNCG, but I couldn't get into Carolina. So you're smarter than me.
You know, from year to the next, it's harder or easier. And I got lucky that year.
Well, I'll tell you, man, I got that application. It was 17 pages long. And I was like, oh, ECU was like half,
on if they
half
won
page.
A national championship.
Yeah. Well, I will say
your team won.
Yeah. It's hard to get in year after. Yeah. I'm still a Carolina basketball fan, although my daughter's going to Clemson now, so I'm sort of migrating there for football. But, you know, it's never good to have a bad year, but if they were going to have a bad year, this was a good year to have a bad year.
True.
They were a little off, but they say the freshman class coming in is pretty good. So tell us a little bit about those classes. What are you guys offering now? And the deadline, I know the deadline used to be June 10th, but if I'm not mistaken, I think that's been moved back a little bit because of COVID-19. Is that correct?
That's right. The commission, I think, has done a good job of adjusting for this and giving us some leeway, and most importantly, giving the students a little bit of cushion. But it is now September 30th to complete CE and the post. And I guess for those who don't know what those things mean, and back to your original question, what do I teach? All of it. The pre-licensing, the post-licensing, which constitutes three additional 30-hour courses once you get your license that you must complete. Very soon, it's going to be an 18-month deadline to finish all three of those. And then every year, all brokers take continuing ed. So we teach all of it. So those CE and post classes, you do have an extra couple of months through September 30th. But my outlook on that is, hey, what else are you doing? Just knock it out now.
Exactly. Right? Get it done. It's a good time. It's a good time. I mean, you could be, if you don't do something productive, you could find yourself on a Zoom with a dude with a crazy shirt on or something. You know, I'm usually the crazy pants guy, but that doesn't translate very well on the Zoom call. So
I tried. I made the suggestion that you film your feet and the cuffs of your pants. Somehow that came across weird. I don't know.
I hear you. Well, now, speaking of the classes, an ethics requirement? Is that every 2 years? Is that this year? Or is that different for everybody? I know for at least the local association, don't they have to take ethics every
now,
2 years?
It's every 3 years coming up now. Okay. And then it is a realtor requirement as opposed to a real estate commission requirement. And you can find continuing ed classes, electives that satisfy both a CE requirement and that elective requirement. That is actually the electives that we teach. We teach a couple of them, and they both satisfy both.
Oh, cool. Let me ask you this. How do you – I mean, it's been we've all adjusted. Like, we had to learn Zoom and, you know, WebEx and all this stuff and FaceTime. How have the classes been? I know you've been doing virtual classes. How has that been? I mean, I know it's kind of a hard question to ask, but I'm just sort of – or answer because I don't really know what I'm asking except – there's obviously a difference between live room classes, which we just can't have right now. Beside the obvious, you know, how is it different? I mean, I would think there's advantages and disadvantages, and how are you adjusting, and what do you see as an advantage or a disadvantage?
You know, it goes back to that personality type. If you follow the DISC or the type DISC, A or whatever the method is, a self-awareness is part of this thing. And what I've noticed is that there are some big fans and there's some big anti-fans. I am what they call an introvert by identity and an extrovert by role, because I'm naturally an introvert, but I have to be an extrovert just to do the things that I choose to do. And I like being an extrovert in limited doses.
You could choose, yeah.
I need to decompress after I spend a whole day teaching, as opposed to an extrovert would probably go out to a club and keep on entertaining and being around people. These classes, I like it. You have to do a little bit more. You have to work harder to keep them engaged. Mm-hmm. You know, there's nothing like seeing an actual human face. And if they get it, if that light bulb is going off, and there's less of that. Yeah. It's hard to, especially in a room full of 85 to 100 Zoom attendees, which is what we're dealing with. And that's tough. It takes a two instructor approach. And that's what we're doing. We're usually one instructor would be leading a class. We're doing it. We're tag teaming. And is kind of monitoring the chat window. And then the other is kind of handling the main teaching aspect. And we trade off. So, and then you do other things like using the Zoom poll feature, and there's this other teaching app called Kahoot. We've used that to kind of keep the interest up because it scores their answers, and you have to keep attendance. But the one overarching thing that has helped relax all of this a little bit that the commission said is, for right now, with this emergency plan, they're calling it, no testing is required by us, the commission. We, the school, could utilize testing if we want, but the commission's not requiring it like they normally do. And that takes some pressure off.
Yeah, it's sort of, you know, different, you know, because I go, you know, I sponsor classes and stuff, and I'm so used to going to them. I mean, one thing that's nice is, you know, I I can do stuff around the house until 10 minutes before. Right. So, whereas before, you know, if the class is in Mooresville, man, I got to leave an hour and a half early to get there, you know. But, I mean, I prefer live classes, I think, just because of the live interaction. But there are some cool things. And I think if there's something good that comes out of the – I mean, you know, obviously none of us wanted this whole thing. It kind of forced all of us to get better at technology. And I think, you know, before asking somebody to get on a Zoom would have been like, I think now it'll be an easy thing for people to do.
Sure.
It is convenient. And I concur. I'm just like you, man. I masquerade as an extrovert. People think I'm an extrovert. I'm really – it wears me out, man.
That surprises me.
Yeah, I can go to a party, and I can turn it on, and I come home, and I'm like, oh, my God, I just want to crawl under the covers. Where I got a good buddy, Tripp, man, this guy, he's life of the party. And like you said, want to go to the club after. He gets energy from people. And it takes energy for me, and I can do it, and I don't mind doing it because it's part of the job. But boy, I just soon, you know, go watch Netflix or read a book or something after.
You hide it well. I would have never guessed.
Yeah, it just takes a lot of energy. Well, let's move. Oh, well, before we go to that, tell us a little bit about, and we'll circle back to this towards the end of the interview too, but if they want to find out more about you guys' offerings and stuff, where can they find out more about that?
Sure. The website, there's a Facebook page and a website. The school site is ncacschool.com. They can get the schedule and register for classes. And then same name for the Facebook page.
Okay. As well. And that's for it's Agent's Choice.
Agent's Choice School of Real Estate. That's right. Mm-hmm.
Cool. And tell Margie and John I said hello.
Will do. I actually, your podcast intro video, I saw that picture, you and Margie. It popped out at me.
Oh, yeah. I love Margie.
One of the many, many pictures in there.
Yeah. Yeah. I went back. I mean, I kept all those pictures from all those. I mean, I didn't even go through. At some point I had to cut it off. I was like, I was doing it late at night, and I was like, I'm going to stay up all night going through these pictures. But, you know, that was kind of the idea for the podcast was, you know, in 23 years or so doing inspections, meeting folks like you and, you know, Margie and Bill and, you know, all these other, you know, and these agents. And, you know, I was like, I need to like, and there's something in them that drives them, that makes them successful. And I was like, there's something there and I ought to bring that out. Or, you know, what do they have in common or what is the common thread? And I was like, I need to start a podcast. So there we are. And you were on the short list. Idea.
You're doing great.
Well, switching gears a little bit over to the real estate side, and we're going to have some fun kind of on the back end of this. We'll take care of the business first and then then have some fun. What do you feel about coaching? Have you done coaching? Do you recommend coaching? And, you know, there's a lot of agents out there listening to this or just got their license. What would you say to them if they ask you about coaching?
You know, as long ago as it was, 23 years, I still remember that first year and the feelings. And it's just like when you graduate from high school or college, you come out of there and the last thing you want to do is to keep learning. You just want to go do stuff.
Right.
And so once you get past that and you realize, oh, wait, I just got my real estate license. Now I just know the laws and rules and how not to go to real estate jail, but I really don't know how to make a business out of this thing. That's when I realized it took me a year or so to get my first couple sales. You're in a hurry to hurry up and accomplish that. And then the coaching just gets you past a sticking point, gets you to not plateau. I've met plenty of 10, 15, 20-year veteran agents who act like it's their first year because they've never built upon their wisdom and knowledge. And they're still locked into this little tiny sphere, this little teeny fishbowl. So the coaching is crucial for growth, whether it's the form of books and courses to start with. I've spent thousands of dollars and many hours. I've been involved with way back when Floyd Wickman Sweat Hogs program was.
I remember that.
That was the first one I did. I've been involved with Howard Brenton, the Howard Brenton or Star Power Club, Brian Buffini, and some more modern ones. There's a guy named Ryan Fletcher. There's Krista Mayshore. She's really up and coming and killing it right now. And you know, part of it is mindset, and it should be, because sometimes you, both sides of the bed are the wrong side of the bed to get up from that day.
Yeah.
And you have to put yourself in a place to be in front of people, especially in this business. So the coaching is crucial for growth, and discomfort is crucial for growth. The minute you get comfortable, you know, that's not a groove, that's a rut. You need to be constantly somewhat uncomfortable, right?
And that's happened to me several times. I got comfortable, and that's when I let my guard down, so to speak. How do you feel about, like, if a new agent – I'm playing a new agent here, coming to a seasoned agent.
I know a lot of them.
What all right, so Neal, tell me about lead generation. What you know, there's all different types and forms. What do you think, you know, as a new agent, what would I – you know, what would be my best – lead generation activities? Should I pay for leads? How do you feel about that? You know, or what? You know, I don't have a whole lot of money. I'm a new agent. I mean, what would you recommend that I do?
It reminds me of that 18th birthday, and we all experienced it. We hit it, and what happened in the next month or two? A million credit card applications.
Yeah.
Well, you get your real estate license, and you get a million solicitations for, I'll sell you leads, or I'll give you this or that. Even the brokers that you interview with, they know what you want. You want training, and some are actually going to go through with their promises of training, and your job to figure out who's really going to do it. So lead gen is that thing I was talking about earlier, how the laws on the rules, and that's all you really know. The next step is to fill up the bucket, right?
Right.
You've learned how to not break the rules. Now you got to learn how to do the business and fill out the forms, but also how to get somebody for whom to do the business. And it's that constant set roller coaster. You know, you're on cloud nine, you got the license, you're out doing what they tell you to do, open houses, maybe floor time or phone duty or call opportunity, whatever they call it. You right. get a lead, and you hang on to that lead, and you're scared to death, and you work it as best you can. But all those calls you were making, you got in the habit of for the previous 3 months, every day you called. Well, now that kind of falls by the wayside. So then it becomes this roller coaster. You close on that first deal, and your prospecting is gone. So the number one goal I tell people, even while they're still working on pre-licensing, assemble your list. The beauty is in the list. Who is your on your list? You have one, friends and family, acquaintances, start building that list. And there's a million free social media resources that you could put content on. You need to right. be seen as an authority. And you are, even though it's your first day, the average consumer, if you just know this much more than them, to them, you're an expert. And you can... Yeah. I'm not even going to say fake it till you make it, because you legitimately are helping them and know more than them in some amount. You at least know more experience in where to find the answer. And you don't have to lay out all the cards on the table. You can say, oh, well, you know what? Let me check on that and get back to you. I'd do that today. I'm not ashamed to not know the answer.
Oh, yeah,
and that's another difference between a new one and an aged veteran. You know, you're not as bothered by that. I had a huge chip on my shoulder in the early days. I was scared to death because I lived at home as a 24-year-old, brand newly licensed. I just thought some client was going to jump out of the bushes and say, you don't even own your own house. Why are you helping me? And they never did. So, you know, they don't care. All they care about is that relationship, which leads to the next big headline that I tell students. Relationship over transaction.
Yeah.
Don't compromise the relationship just to get the commission. Don't compromise the rules or certainly not the laws just to get a commission. And we could go into loan fraud and all that other stuff too. But you ask about lead gen. I say cater to your list. Be love on the people on your list. Take people to lunch. Talk to them. Just be honest. And it reminds me of Gary Vaynerchuk. Are you familiar?
Oh, yeah. Gary V. 100%.
Yeah. As an instructor, I try to incorporate some of his stuff a little bit, at least during the breaks, but it's so hard because I try to keep any offensive stuff out.
I was starting to say, just don't drop the F-bomb.
There are.
I told iTunes. Yeah. I told iTunes we're clean.
Yeah. All of YouTube has four clips without any Gary V F-bombs.
Yeah.
So I'm limited, but what he says is to cater to those you know, to work hard, and you're young, you know, especially you're never too old to learn and to grow. So That's a whole nother story. We could talk about Gary V forever.
Oh yeah. But I'm big Gary V.
Cater into that sphere and loving on them and checking in with them. We're in a, it's so funny. The name social media is not at all social. You know, it's tools and softwares and apps designed to be kind of antisocial in terms of physical proximity.
That's true.
It's all designed to not be in the same room. So mix them up. Let's use the social to set up the in-person, and don't forget some of that old school stuff. Don't forget about dropping off something for somebody and taking them to lunch and giving them a call. This is a great time to call people and see how they're doing, because this is a big concerning issue for people to get through. So, yeah.
You know what I still think works? I mean, I love all the new gadgets and the new things, but man, a handwritten letter still, and it, even more so now, because you know, it's funny, I go through my mail, and if there's anything handwritten, I will open that and look, because I know somebody took the time to write that. And, you know, there's a secret. I don't know if it's a secret, but if you really want to get stand out, do a handwritten letter.
Hello, I'm Bill Gallagher with Superior School of Real Estate, and I'm here with Preston Sandlin of Home Inspection Carolina. Preston, I've always liked your style, especially those pants. And also, I've been interested in the home inspection business for a long time.
Well, Bill, that's ironic. I've always admired your style, and I've always admired your ability to educate these fine folks for sometimes 4-8 hours a day. I wish that I could do what you do.
Hey, Preston, wouldn't it be cool if we switched? Preston, we sure got what we wished for, buddy.
We sure did. And now that you're the expert, Bill, I mean, you are wearing the pants. And I'm the instructor and the educator. Tell us what Home Inspection Carolina is doing these days to make the home buying process easier for realtors and home buyers.
Well, Preston, all our home inspection reports now are online for the real estate agent and the client to review the report online and to be able to create a repair list basically online by either clicking repair, accept, monetary compensation, and once they prepare the request, they can then press email, text, or print right then.
You mean it's all automated, Bill?
Absolutely. We are high tech.
Wow. What else is Home Inspection Carolina doing different these days?
Well, Preston, we're training our home inspectors to be non-alarmist. We are training them to put things into perspective and to simplify the message for the hopeful homeowner.
Non-alarmist is key, Bill. You remember those days of the 100-page reports and those 3-ring binders that would just go on and on and on, la 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 la. Thank you for being a good non-alarmist.
And Preston, one more thing. We fix the small stuff for free. Do you remember when home inspectors always put those little nitpicky items on those reports?
Oh, bless their hearts.
Well, at Home Inspection Carolina, if we can fix it in 5 minutes or less, we do it for free. We're better with a caulk gun than a keyboard any day. We just fix it.
You mean there's no cost for this, Bill?
Preston, it's free.
Wow.
Well, Preston, these pants really are a catch.
Well, Bill, I've enjoyed wearing the suit, but I don't think I could wear it every day because I got to fix the small stuff for free, and I don't want to ruin a good suit.
Preston, it's been a lot of fun flipping the switch.
You'll get somebody's attention because it's so rare now, you know?
Yeah, it's so rare.
Well, let me ask you this, and we're going to get to some fun stuff here too. How do you feel about scripts? And, and I do a lot of I'm in coaching groups, and you know, I've taken a lot of real estate classes because I want to understand. You know, a lot of business comes from you guys, so I definitely want to understand. I actually have my real estate license too, but I don't compete with you guys. I got it for the key way back. But I go back and forth. Sometimes I thought scripts were great, but then I think, well, do you sound so robotic if you're all these scripts? And it's sort of like, okay, they say that, now I say this, you know. But I don't know. I sort of feel you need to have, you know what the after a while of calling FSBOs or expired listings, you probably know what the objection. There's probably, if you do it a long time, there's probably not going to be a new objection that you haven't heard. So you start formulating response. I mean, I guess I should let you answer this. I keep going on and on, but how do you feel about scripts and especially in objections and things like that, and FSBOs and calling expired listings and that sort of thing?
Scripts and the part that I got on a rabbit trail and didn't answer before about paid leads, it all comes down to this. It's my favorite advice in the classroom when an agent says, "What? How should I do it? What should I do?" And I say, it depends. I say adult diapers. You know, that's me crazy. Like, what? Yeah, it depends. So as to scripts, absolutely. Scripts are great. They put you on a level playing field. They give you a chance to have ahead of time figured out what are some good ways that are going to handle this issue. But the key is, the secret sauce is in practicing it enough so it doesn't sound rehearsed.
Yeah.
It's got to flow naturally. And the minute it sounds like something you're just saying because you're supposed to say it, you've lost the effect of it.
And
be done right.
I'm sure we've all met those people that it feels like every time you talk to them, you're on their script. And like, right. It's like too slick and too salesy. You know, it's just like, yes. Oh, I never want to be that guy, man. Even though I'm wearing a used car salesman shirt, I don't want to be that guy. But then again, you know, you obviously got to have a goal or an objective and, you know, some ideas of how this thing's going to go. Well, let me ask you this, Neal. You've known a lot of people. You rub shoulders and been around, and yourself, successful people in this business. And some people succeed in real estate and some people wash out. I actually do the new agent orientation now, and you know, I've got to the point where, you know, I'm looking, there's a room of 80 people in my mind. I'm like, I wonder which ones will succeed and which ones will wash out. I mean, I don't mean to sound bad, but it's just, it's the way it happens. So a couple of questions. What do you think is the common ingredient in the people who succeed? And, you know, everybody has different styles and, you know, you don't have to do it the same way, but there has to be some common ingredient. And, you know, what makes the difference between the people who succeed and the people who wash out? And it's a tough business. I mean, it's a tough business.
It is. Well, for one thing, the numbers are alone are kind of working against you. There's, I believe, 106,000 licensees in the state of North Carolina right now. Thankfully, not all active. Only about 70,000 are active. Still not making you feel any better. Okay, well, of those 70, a huge majority aren't really doing much with it at all. So right. It doesn't really matter what those numbers are. Point being, though, everybody knows somebody. Right. And you have to stand out. And how do you stand out? You do things that don't turn you into a commodity. You make them appreciate your knowledge and willing to work. The work ethic is sort of a time tested ever since forever. Nothing beats that.
Right.
And then don't be a secret agent. And now more than ever, it's easy to fix that. Back in the day, you had to spend serious money to tell the whole world what you were about via postcards, maybe real radio and television ads. Now we all have it in our pocket. It's just that those of us who are using it are going to be ahead of those who maybe aren't realizing the value of that. So publishing this free content that you make with that phone in your pocket that you have anyway on these free social media avenues so that people see you for who you are and maybe resonate and pick a side. Don't be everything to everybody. That's been a mistake of mine forever. I tried to be a generalist. And time has tested and told that the niche specialists are the ones who really take off the fastest, because people are like, oh, that's an expert in FHA loans or VA loans.
Or equine property or horse properties or something like
something.
That.
Especially as a new agent, that way you just have a little teensy thing to really get really good at. And now you're an expert at it, maybe even ahead of a 10-year veteran because they didn't focus on something that minute.
Yeah. Let me ask you this, Neal. If you woke up tomorrow morning in a brand new world, brand new planet, you still had all your real estate knowledge, you still had all your real estate stuff, still had everything you got, but it's a brand new world. You don't know anybody, but you still have everything. You've got room and board taken care of, but you got to get out in this new world and market people. For some reason, you're in some new city, but it's very similar to Charlotte. What are you going to do if you've got $1,500 What are you going to do to get out there and get known? Room and board's taken care of. You don't have to worry about that equipment, but what are you going to do to, you got $1,500. How are you going to get known?
The creation of that content is important. I'm assuming you would already have a phone, but, you could probably get a couple of extra things like that to kind of help make those things more exciting, a GoPro or a 360 camera or something.
Oh, I've seen you had that. Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah, that's, put it on your drone. Fun. Yeah. Yeah.
Yep. So something to make an impact online. And then it's all about getting in front of people. Going back to the basics, you don't even need to spend the money except for buying some people some lunches, right? Go take some people to lunch, and then you're going to start to meet key people. And then just establishing that. It sounds boring, but establish that list and cater to them. Send them things. Make them remember that you do this thing. So, you know, it doesn't take much once you get up and running. Now, the person who's brand new starting and is in my pre-licensing class and thinks that for the $400 or $500 of the class, after that and some time and study, they're ready. And I have to give them the bad news. Well, you need another $1,200 or $1,500 after that just to start with the memberships and this and that. You know, some people don't realize those things. But the stuff that really works is usually the stuff that doesn't cost that much.
Oh, totally.
Stuff that's tried and true. Now, the paid lead thing, I'm not going to cast any sort of negativity on that. That could work for some people. There's plenty that don't. You know, be careful where you're getting them. Ask the questions. Are they scrubbed? Where are they coming from? And then think about, how do I want to approach this? Is this one of those paid lead things where they send the one lead to five people and we're in a race to get in front of them?
Right.
And therefore, surprised that client just thinks of us as just maybe less than how we want to be thought of because we're fighting over each other. That's the one negative that I would kind of caution against. Make sure you elevate. Let's lift our industry up and not be seen as just clawing and scraping and that negative connotation. That's the only drawback I see from that approach. But I know plenty of newer agents that are just killing it because they're plugged in to a certain network of paid leads. And as long as it works, great.
Yeah, you know, I do home inspections, and I get called, and I don't want to say the name of, because I don't want to get sued, but companies that do leads for contractors and things like that. And, it works for some guys in some markets, but from what I understood, they sell that same lead to multiple people. Now, I'm not saying real estate. This is the contractor leads, and I just
– Oh, they do.
And I mean, it might work for some people, but I would rather market in a different way. And I don't want to, you know, be calling a bunch of people that have already received. That's just me. But I, you know, again, that's my opinion. You know, that's just my opinion. It may work for some people, and I'm not knocking those people. I mean, you know.
You know, the difference is, are you paying somebody else to do everything, and therefore you're going to get maybe less results? You know, if you do a lead generation company, you got to vet it properly and see, is it even worth it? I would rather take my own budget and apply it toward, let's just say, Facebook ad dollars, where I can pick my own circle around the geographical area and pick my own likes and dislikes of, like, signed up to appreciates realtors as a path. If you're, for you, you'd be catering to realtors. So maybe you pick people who have liked the NAR or something. So you're getting maybe in front of those realtor eyeballs. And it used to be a lot more streamlinable, but between various reasons, one of which the best reason being some fair housing violations, Facebook needed to change things a little bit and not make it so tweakable because they were in danger and jeopardy of violating some things that don't need to be violated.
Yeah.
But you can still focus in really well with Facebook.
Yeah. And you can offer, I mean, you know, again, there's a million different ways to do it, but you could offer some free, you know, a lot of people offer free CMAs, see what your house is worth. You know, the other thing is, you know, you could write a little ebook. I mean, like, you know, five things everybody needs to know when buying a house, or five mistakes, or, and it doesn't have to be five. I'm just seven mistakes homeowners, you know, like, free book. Oh, wow. I need that. Run a Facebook ad. And then obviously everybody who downloads that free book, they're going to have to put in their email and phone number. And, if they're interested, and there's a million different ways. I mean, you could put a listing on there, and you know, but like you said, the good thing about this is you're creating your own leads, and it's not controlled by another company that, you know, tomorrow decides to go up on the price or sell it to 10 people instead of three. Sure. You know, you're in control of it. Mm-hmm. So I like that. But, you know, whatever works for, you know, I'm not knocking and not talking junk to anybody else who, you know, whatever they decide to do.
Well,
go ahead.
To that point, don't forget it's dynamic. So that might work great for a season. But if as it gets more popular, becomes more saturated, maybe the business decision is to, okay, I've exhausted this. Let's go on to something else now. So don't be married to any one thing.
Awesome. One more question, and then we're at the lightning round. What is the wildest, craziest, or weirdest story you've ever come across in real estate with you, or, you know, somehow you knew about it, and you can change the names or to protect the innocent or the guilty. And we've had some doozies. This is my fourth one. We've had some doozies. Somebody changed clothes, like they came from the workout to go show a house, and they changed clothes on the porch, and they had one of those doorbell things. Like, yikes.
Yes, everybody's watching these days.
Yeah, man. My daughter's actually delivering now for DoorDash or something, and she made $60 yesterday, and she delivered like pet food and something. She didn't even have to see him, but I told her, I was like, honey, you do realize every time you get on that porch, you're on camera. Yes. Not that you would do anything weird or anything, but just be aware of that.
Always on stage, on camera, really.
Yeah.
This is and I hate to do this, but you asked, it's a little on the creepy side, but there was a time when, I showed a house to the single mom with her 9-year-old daughter, and they walked through the living room. Thankfully, they didn't see what I saw right as I was following up behind them. I glanced to the right on top of the TV, and there was a very graphic DVD case on top of the TV. And I looked at them to see if they were looking back. They had totally missed it. So there was a newspaper, and I just tossed it on top of that thing, told the agent, who was actually in my office at the time, hey, this happened. And she said, oh, sorry. Well, the elderly husband is home alone for the week while his wife is out of town.
Ooh.
So a year later, I thought about that story and asked her about it. And she said, yeah, they're divorced now. Not to bring down the room. Sorry about that.
No. Well, you know, the funny thing is I guess there for a while, it was like an exercise thing, you know, the poles or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I actually went, it was on the weekend, and you know, one of my other guys had set out a radon box, so it was close to my house. So it's a really nice house, not too far from here. And you know, would I pick it up? Because you know, he lived up in Concord actually, and I was like, yeah, sure, I'll pick it up. So I actually had my kids with me in the car, and it was a nice house. You know, I had my key and everything. So you know, I go in there, and there's a stripper pole. And I'm like, tell me about this. And you know, that wouldn't have been a big deal, but my kids were trailing behind me. Unfortunately, they were young at the time. Like, Daddy, what is that? Why is it so shiny? And I'm like, it's a support column, honey.
Don't touch it.
Yeah, exactly. And then what's even crazier, you know, I kind of, without my kids noticing, I snapped a picture of it, you know, and of course I put it on Facebook, but I didn't put any addresses or anything like that. And the listing agent recognized it. It's like, oh, yeah, you were invited. She wasn't mad, thank gosh. Turned out that person was like some famous therapist that had written books, and that was like exercise or something. I don't know, but
it's a thing now.
Yeah, and crazy enough, one of my daughter's best friends wind up living right beside those people, and I kind of always wondered, did y'all get rid of the pole? That's just something that, you know, how do I bring that up in conversation without
being, write that in the contract properly? Pole conveys.
Exactly. All right, Neal. Well, we're about to hit the lightning round here, so I'm going to have you finish these song lyrics for 2 points if you can.
Oh boy.
You ready?
Okay. All right. We'll see.
And I know you're a guitar guy.
I got a hot rod Ford and a $2 bill, and I know a spot right over the hill. There's soda pop and the dancing's free, so if you want to have fun, come along with me. Say, hey.
Good luck.
And You got it, man. Good looking. You got it. Hey, good looking. What you got cooking? I picked that for two reasons. I looked at your profile, and you liked Hank Williams, and I knew you're a guitar guy. And I told my kids we went to Nashville back around right before Christmas.
I did, too.
Did you? It was awesome, wasn't it?
Before my honeymoon.
Did you? Oh, yeah. Congratulations. But I told my kids, you know, we did the – did you do the Country Music Hall of Fame and all that? And I kind of told him, I was like, you know, we saw all these people, and I said, but there's somebody missing here, you know, and missing out of the Grand Ole Opry. And honestly, it all goes back to them. But, you know, Hank was a partier, I guess, and, you know, you know, there's so much influence that goes back to Hank Williams. So, you know, that guy, you know.
Legend.
Yeah, oh, yeah. And even in Hank Williams Jr., too. I mean, you know, and I think there's a certain amount of pride. Well, I think – I don't know. That's a whole different podcast. But
well, you know, old school country versus new country?
Yeah, well, that and yeah. I love outlaw country. Anyway, but
– I went to school with Hank's senior's grandkid, so Hank Jr.'s kid.
Oh, wow.
For a year or two. It was a private Christian school that I was at for a little while, and he was there, and everybody, of course – oh my gosh, your dad is that guy.
I think there would be
plays now.
Yeah, it would be an enormous amount of pressure, though, to be, you know, a son or daughter of anybody that, you know, I mean, poor like Michael Jordan's kid. I mean, you know, if you're not great, like, dude, what, you know. But anyway, all right, lightning round. You did well. You got 2 points on that. Now we're going to play this or that. So I'm going to give you two things, and you tell me which one. Dog or cat?
Dog.
Netflix or YouTube?
YouTube.
Phone call or text?
Text.
Cardio or weights?
Weights.
Ginger or Marianne?
Ooh.
I know that's a tough one.
Wait a minute. Let me refer back to something real quick here.
Ginger or Marianne?
Yes. Let's just say Marianne.
Marianne. iOS or Android?
I'm such a traitor. I've done both. Currently Android.
Me too.
But I have an iPad and a MacBook.
I have an iPad, but I have Android, but I'm the only one in my house. Everybody else, and I was an iPhone guy. I didn't like it when they got rid of the jack.
That annoyed me.
Yeah and you got to have
manipulative.
Yeah, you got to either have a converter or, you know.
A dongle.
And I can't keep up with charging something else. It was just too much. So that's when I went Android, but my whole family gives me a hard time.
Same.
Football or basketball?
Football.
Football.
But not by much.
Yeah, well, if in basketball, Michael Jordan or LeBron James?
Really?
Well, you're a Carolina guy. So.
Legend.
Yeah.
The original legend, let's say that.
There you go. What's worse having to do, laundry or dishes?
Dishes.
What would you rather do, jogging or hiking?
Hiking.
Tennis shoes or flip-flops?
Tennis shoes. You never know when you're going to have to run away from somebody.
Especially in this business. Online shopping or shopping at a store?
Online.
Car or truck?
Truck.
Blue or red?
Blue.
Being a Carolina guy. Money or free time?
Ooh, let's go with time. That's more.
Yeah, I think so too. You can't make more of it, but you can make more money. Amusement park like Carowinds or a day at the beach?
Beach.
Hold on, got one or two more, and then the most important one's the last one. Beach or mountains?
Depends again, but let's just say beach.
Winter or summer?
Summer.
Mac or PC?
Mac.
Sweater or hoodie?
Hoodie.
When sleeping, fan on or fan off?
On.
That's been every single person.
Really?
Yeah. All right. Last and most important question, the toilet paper question. Under or over? Beard or mullet?
The right way. Over.
Over. That's what everybody said. Who are these weird people who do it under? So anyway. Awesome. Well, tell us something about you that we may not know, or some crazy skill like that you have.
I'm not that skillful, but I do really like writing stories, and just writing, period. But I think that also manifests just recently in like writing scripts and planning out for video ideas. And I just had a pretty cool opportunity where my church, you know, everybody's doing the online services.
Right.
And I thought, well, maybe instead of just showing a static image for the 5-minute countdown before the service, we should make a cool little montage video of that. And I had the best time filming. I'm of course the guitar player. And so at the rehearsal, I filmed the singers and the drummer and me. And then I just took little clips and put it in all, set it to a recording I have from our leader from a few years ago, playing this old school bluesy kind of a gospel-y tune. And I had the greatest time thinking of what do I want to convey and how do I do it, and editing that into a thing. But I also just like pen to paper. Well, I don't like to write so much because I'd rather just type it out. It's faster.
Yeah.
I like to read and write. That's kind of this thing I would do if I could just do anything without money being an object. And of course, music. I'd love to take professional lessons from all the major stars if I could just afford to take lessons from anybody and just go around and take lessons from rock stars all the time.
I hear you, brother. Well, you're kind of gadgety too, because you're into we're almost done here, but I gotta ask you about this, your drone. And I'm into drones, you know. It's a tax write-off toy. I mean, a roof inspection. That's how I justify it, to inspect roofs. But whatever, I'm all into. Looks like you have. Is it the Mavic? What do you have?
No, it's just a GoPro Karma.
The Karma.
Discontinued it, and it's. I don't mind because it's been a rough ride getting used to it.
Yeah.
I did better when I first got it. The other day, I pulled it out, and I got worse. Crashed it pretty bad.
Oh,
but I have enough space to kind of fly it. But the DJI Mavic Air 2 is the next thing I've got on the list in another couple of months, maybe. But something, once I get a little more practiced, so I don't feel so bad when they inevitably gets crashed. But it's great fun. I just need to do the certification. Have you done that yet?
I got about halfway through it, and it was like during the busy season, and I got busy, and now would be a great time. You can do it almost all online, but
I want to use it, but I guess I could use it in more of the vlogging community based. I have a community Facebook group that I've put together, and I'm starting to add content to, called Impact Concord NC. And I'll probably utilize some of that, cause that's not profit. You know, it's not a for-profit endeavor. So I think I can use it for that sort of thing.
Awesome.
But yeah, I've been experimenting with a 360 camera and glued it on the top of the drone the other day. And that might have been what threw me off a little bit. But yeah, it's fun. I like to tinker with the technology.
Awesome. Well, Neal, thank you for being with us today. You've given lots of valuable information. How can we, if the listeners, our viewers out there, you know, want to follow up, maybe take some classes or you know, or just contact you, how could they do that?
All the ways. So, of course, the school website, again, ncacschool.com is the agent's choice. My website is impactcarolinasrealty.com. And then Facebook, you can look me up, Neal Pender. I have an Impact Carolinas Realty page. I have a Impact Concord NC Facebook group. And I'm on Instagram, too. So,
awesome. Well, Neal, we sure do appreciate your time.
Thank you, sir.
I'll see you shortly because I think we're doing another one.
Yeah, looking forward to it.
All right, brother. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
You've been listening to the Successful Real Estate Broker Podcast with your host, Preston Sandlin. Join us on the next episode where we'll be talking to a successful agent or vendor about the right things to do and the wrong things you should avoid. Join us on the next episode of the Successful Real Estate Broker Podcast.